to this, the 12th meeting of 2015 of the European and External Relations Committee, and our last meeting before we rise for summer recess. Can I make the usual request that mobile phones are switched off and onto silent, please? We have, as you see, a very, very full agenda this morning, so we're going to move on very, very swiftly. Agenda item one is the UK's future relationship with the EU and part of our Connecting Scotland inquiry. And I'm delighted to welcome back to the committee this morning Cabinet Secretary for Culture and Europe and External Affairs, Fiona Hyslop. Welcome, Cabinet Secretary. And Colin Imrie, who's a Deputy Director and Head of European Relations, Scottish Government. Welcome back also to yourself, Mr Imrie, to our committee this morning. Cabinet Secretary, I believe you've got a brief opening statement.
Yes, thank you very much and good morning, Convener. Thanks for the invitation to speak to you this morning. I'm aware that the committee has continued with the second strand of the Connecting Scotland inquiry since my last appearance and that you've been taking evidence on the UK's relationship with the EU in response to the UK's announcement of an in-out referendum on the UK's EU membership. And I'd like to take the opportunity to outline the government's position on some of the points that the committee considered during its session on EU reform and the EU referendum. The Scottish Government believes the referendum bill currently being debated in Westminster falls short. It fails to meet the standards required. Firstly, whilst we welcome the decision of the UK Government not to hold a referendum on the same day as next year's elections to the Scottish Parliament, it's very disappointing that despite the best efforts of many MPs, the franchise will not be extended to 16 and 17-year-olds. Especially disappointing given that this group showed beyond doubt that they were able to take part in the independence referendum debate as mature, conscientious citizens, and they deserve their say in their future. Secondly, 171,000 EU citizens have chosen to make Scotland their home, and the case for extending the vote to them in the EU referendum is strong. But again, it is wrong that there is no provision in the current bill for this to happen. The Scottish Government will continue to argue that double majority voting should apply to this referendum. It cannot be right that if Scotland votes in favour of remaining in the EU, it could still be dragged out against its will. That is why the Scottish Government is committed to explaining why Scotland and the UK should remain in the EU, and we will argue the positive case for the UK and Scotland's continued membership of the EU. Before the referendum, the Prime Minister wants to renegotiate the terms of the UK's membership of the EU. It's vital that Scotland's voice is heard in this process and that Scotland's interests are protected, and we shall be pursuing this with the UK Government. It's still too early to tell exactly what the Prime Minister wants or indeed whether his proposals will require treaty change. This may become clearer during the European Council meeting, which begins today, and in areas where there is common cause, for example, around better regulation, we will support the UK, but proposals to change immigration rules could be difficult for us to accept given the benefits of immigration to our country. In my view, the real risk to the UK's membership of the EU is that the renegotiation process between the UK and the Member States is defined in terms of there being winners and losers. That could polarise opinion and focus minds only on what the Prime Minister achieves, ignoring the benefits of the EU and what it delivers right now. The whole point about a more effective European Union is that everyone should gain from it. Compromise should not, in my view, mean concession. I've said before that the EU is not perfect and some areas are in need of reform, and that is why we published our agenda for EU reform in August, which highlights how this the EU institutions must prioritise policies which are responsive to and reflect the concerns of its citizens. We believe that reform that would be beneficial to all Member States can take place within the existing treaty framework. This could include more autonomy for Member States to tackle pressing issues such as public health or the completion of the single market in services. And we also make the case for regulatory reform to address the stock of EU legislation which imposes unnecessary burdens on enterprise and citizens. Turning to a couple of other points, the committee will know that I'm greatly concerned by the humanitarian crisis in the Mediterranean. We will encourage the UK Government to play its part in implementing the priority actions proposed under the EU agenda on migration. We recognise our obligations to refugees and continue to press the UK Government to participate fully in proposed EU action, including relocation and resettlement. I also want to put on record the Scottish Government is committed to the European Convention on Human Rights and will robustly and unequivocally oppose any proposals which weaken its protection. And finally, on the Connecting Scotland inquiry, I welcome the evidence that shows the great variety of Scottish organisations that engage internationally for the benefit of our local communities and partners worldwide. The Government recognises and values the contribution to Scotland's positive global reputation very highly. The international framework, which we discussed at my last session with you, and our internationalisation agenda demonstrate the Government's commitment to support Scottish organisations in their international engagement, and will continue our dialogue with stakeholders on how this can best be done, and I'm happy to answer any questions you have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Much like our committee agenda this morning, you managed to pack a lot into that short statement. Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, I know that the Council meeting is the EU Council meeting starts today, but the two top agenda items are migration, for example, the Mediterranean crisis, and the Greek situation. So is there... Would you agree there is scope for suggesting that these two very important issues are much more important than maybe some of the other agenda items that have been suggested for the meeting today?
Well, one of the concerns, I think, is reasonable, is that British politicians tend to see their priorities as the main priorities and not recognise that actually, in a kind of either European or global sense, there are other issues that are taking precedence, and our focus might not always be their focus. Clearly, the Greek situation is paramount and is being discussed and resolved, I hope. In terms of the Mediterranean situation, interesting, our reform EU agenda for reform in EU, we actually talked about the need back in August that actually that should be part of how the EU addressed some of the issues, and they've still not got to terms that. The agenda they have on migration is very, very important, but reports coming out of the European Council, particularly from the Italians, and again, this the Parliament and indeed Committee, have been very sensitive to the pressures that are on the Italians in particular, but recognising the issue actually is European-wide. So quite rightly, those two agenda items are going to be dominating, and that's understandably so. Reports seem to be that David Cameron will be having those discussions about his negotiations for a revised situation over the informal dinner this evening. We don't know until we hear reports as to what is said, indeed, and what is asked. But you're quite right that to focus that just because it's important to our Prime Minister and David Cameron with the United Kingdom doesn't mean it's top of the agenda for other European countries.
Yeah. Last week, Cabinet Secretary, in this Parliament, we commemorated and celebrated Refugee Week, and we had a reception here, and one of the guest speakers was a survivor of the Mediterranean, and he lost people in a really horrific boat incident last year. His story was very, very, very compelling, not just the tragedies that he'd been through, but the humanity he'd been shown in Italy, and then when he arrived here. The Scottish Government has said that they would be interested in relocation and resettlement. Do you think under the UN Convention for the Refugees that that's a responsibility that we have, is not just as a government, not just as a country, but as a human race, that, you know, when people are in need, you put out that hand and you don't then just conflate it with an artificial debate about migration and immigration being a bad thing?
It's interesting, the debate on human rights has perhaps been within the UK, and that a lot of the issues around human rights have tended to focus on perhaps what are perceived as negative areas or very technical areas or very legal areas, where of course the whole point about human rights and Convention of Human Rights is to make sure that the best standards of humanitarian response exist on a global scale. And in relation to the issues, There are a number of dimensions to this. One is absolutely the response on a humanitarian level, and I'm very heartened by the collective response cross-party in the Parliament in recent debates and questions that we've had in this chamber, recognising that focus and emphasis. Yes, there has to be immediate response to what's happening in the Mediterranean as of now, but this is not something that's new or happened. There have been tens of thousands of people anticipated, expected or are estimated to have died in the Mediterranean been over a period of decades. Now, the causes of the issue have to be resolved. They're not going to be resolved immediately. Some of them are war-torn consequences of war-torn countries. Some of it is in relation, and will increasingly be in relation to what is happening in the north of Africa, in particular in relation to climate change over the long term, where, you know, unless collectively, and another reason why we have to act collectively, whether within the European Union or wider, is tackling climate change, because long-term pressures will cause issues of migration from that source, as well as the economic issues, as well as indeed the asylum issues from people that are fleeing conflict areas, and the responsibility for some of the degree of conflict there can be cast on the United Kingdom over recent decades of how they've behaved in different wars and different activities. So that is a collective responsibility on a whole load of different issues and areas. And I think there's a danger in conflating the immediate short-term issue of humanitarian rescue just now, and saying, well, it's an either-or. You either do that or you try and tackle the long-term strategic issues. You can do both, and it's a requirement that they do both. But again, an argument of why the EU has to do this collectively is that just because Italy is the first port of call of people seeking to come to Europe, it doesn't mean that they have to bear the complete responsibility. And I think it's really important that that is reiterated.
Yeah, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Anne McTaggart.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning, panel. The committee, as you will know, has taken evidence from various sources, and one of the sources in particular that concerns me is the college sector, who have stated within this committee that they have yet to feel the benefit of the international framework. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell me what kind of strategies she has put in place to overcome this?
One of the things that I've done, both in this role and indeed previously when I was the Education Secretary, was to encourage the colleges to think more collectively about what they did in the international area. And indeed, I think it was a former First Minister, Henry McLeish, that was involved with some of the work of Colleges International in terms of what they were doing to try and collectively work to work out, you know, what the main opportunities are and what they can do. I've certainly supported colleges, for example, in China, some of the kind of activities of colleges, particularly there. But a lot of what they have to do in terms of rather than working individually, I think there is something about, and again now with the new regionalisation of colleges, it might be easier more strategically for colleges to work in that area. But, you know, we're always open to discussion with them. Indeed, our colleagues in the education part, or lifelong learning part of the Scottish Government, will be working with them. They have the kind of focus on education international areas as well. But I don't know if, Colin, is there anything you want to add about what the Scottish Government provides for colleges working internationally?
Just to add to the point there, then, I think that it's important to take forward the work with the college sector, see what we can do. There's a lot of work that's done through Scotland Europa and others with regard to the European engagement area, which was an area that I certainly know about most. On a broader sense, I think having a collective approach to that would make it a stronger area. And certainly in our work through the Brussels office, we're very keen to work with the college sector to see what we can do to make that their engagement in the opportunities, the real opportunities that exist, particularly in the vocational area, now that things like Erasmus have been opened out very much to that area, to see how they can take that forward.
I mean, I suppose what some of the opportunities that I think are more obvious is one of the strengths of the Scottish education system is the Scottish credit and qualifications system, and it's one of the few in the world that has both vocational and academic on the same system, and that's an area where the expertise and experience and vocational education that our colleges has is sought and of interest elsewhere. But again, I think that's where that collective approach, saying that we've got models that can work that other countries are interested in. But, you know, a lot of it, they've got to identify what their own asks are and their own approaches.
Yep. Rod Campbell.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Good morning.
Just in terms of what common ground there might be with the UK government in terms of renegotiations. I'm struck by looking at the document that was prepared in August last year, Scotland's agenda for EU reform. Looking at the priority areas, I kind of rather doubted that whether there was much common ground with the UK government, but possibly in the area of regulatory reform there might be. Can you just expand on your view as to where you think there might be any common ground with the UK government?
I think you're right to identify regulation as being one of the key areas we could and should be able to work on. Better regulation has been a big push on from our government, both domestically and in terms of an international area. And you know, we had our own Regulatory Reform Act, for example, in 2014 that set out some of the approaches that we had. Looking at Europe, certainly the REFIT programme from the EU is one that I think we've got a lot to contribute to. And I think, to be fair, the UK government has contributed already in significant terms in terms of that agenda. I think maybe, and I think it's important to work out, well, what are the practical things that could take place that would improve the regulatory framework in Scotland and in the UK with reform? One of the things that we're calling for is proportionate regulation, greater adherence to the principle of proportionality, so that burdensome and complex legislation, which is not necessary to achieve the given objectives, becomes a thing of the past. Where EU legislation provides for sanctions and penalties for non-compliance with its provisions, greater flexibility so that the sanctions and penalties align with the level of risk posed by non-compliance. If you look at consistent regulation, very important to ensure that we prevent competence creep in terms of the European treaties, and indeed where regulations are considered to be more appropriate than directives, and that's quite important. That could, in and of itself, help relieve some of the burdens. Where regulations are considered to be more appropriate than directives, greater use of regulations, which creates framework of principles rather than impose detailed rules, could be helpful in terms of where we are. Accountable regulation and also transparent regulation and more targeted regulation. Now, these things can be achieved, are part of the agenda on REFIT in particular, but also I think could assist and could be done without treaty change. I think that's important. So these are practical things that can be done and is probably an area where not only could there be kind of convergence between what the UK is trying to achieve, what we want, and actually what member states are already working to and towards a reform. So whether you call this a renegotiation or whether you call it a continuance of the reform package, these are things that I think we can have a shared agenda on. I think how they're presented may be different from David Cameron as in terms of his renegotiation, then, as I said at the outset, might be seen or presented by member states. But we've got a good role in leading that, and that's an area of that we could have consensus on, I think.
And in terms of the timetable for the eventual referendum, I don't know whether the Scottish Government has a view at all on that. But also, is there a kind of timetable set up for ongoing dialogue with the UK government as to what's going on beyond the JMCs?
Well, we have asked for a more formal forum to discuss the ongoing issues around negotiation. We've made it quite clear that we should be part of that. That's also something that I think Wales and Northern Ireland would be interested in, because clearly the consequences of some of the issues would have an impact and import on the devolved administrations. That was suggested by our First Minister at the British-Irish Council, which took place just last week on Friday, that we would, that's our proposal of how that can be done. If we just rely on JMCs, the problem with JMCs is that they don't meet that often or that regularly. The last meeting was last week, and Hamza Youssef, the Minister for Europe, attended that again, proposing that there be a better way of making sure that on the ongoing issues of what comes out, even from today and tomorrow, for example, how do we make sure that we've got a better mechanism for knowing what's there. In terms of timescale, I suspect that the Prime Minister will choose a date at which he would be able to have the best result from his perspective. A crystal ball would need to forecast that. I think there's a window, basically. I think it would be extremely unwise to hold a referendum on EU membership relationship during the period of the UK's presidency of the European Council. I think that would just be, for a whole variety of reasons, unwise for everybody. I think in terms of the negotiation period, there's a window there where even already we see the pressures that, and the focus that other countries have on other matters, and we're going into a period probably into 16, 17 of other member states having their own domestic elections, and that may be, you know, closing the window of what is a reasonable period for negotiation for the Prime Minister and his discussions with other countries. So I think, you know, the autumn of 16 looks increasingly the more likely period, but it's not in our gift. The influence that we've managed to bring to bear already with other colleagues in Westminster from different parties is that they shouldn't be, it shouldn't be held on the same day as the Scottish elections. And clearly the views of the Electoral Commission that looked at, you know, the last time there was a UK referendum on constitution issues, and also our own experience of holding local elections and the Parliament elections, there's very good objective response from the Electoral Commission as to what you should do and when you shouldn't do it. But we are preparing for different scenarios, as you would expect us to do, but we would encourage a more engagement from the UK government with the Scottish government, not just on the technicalities of timing, etc., but also on content. And in terms of the ongoing issues, Europe is moving apace on a whole variety of different issues. If we just focus on the areas that of potential renegotiation, there's a danger that actually Scotland and the UK will be left behind on a whole other agenda in relation to the EU. So I would recommend that the engagement is on the long-term strategic issues within the EU, as well as on the negotiation positions of the Prime Minister.
Thank you.
Hanzala Malik.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, this committee is going to be collecting a lot of evidence, and quite rightly so, and it will give an opportunity for a lot of Scots to actually try and understand what is being asked of us, and I think that's important as well. However, what I then want to know is, how do we quickly collate all of that information and put it together? Do we have someone who's going to look at all the information that comes from all the committees to put this together, the proposals of what Scotland's aspirations are and how they should be represented, not only in the UK government, but in the European Commission? Because this is a very serious issue, as you'll appreciate, and I'm just wondering, have we got somebody going to be running with this, somebody in charge who's actually going to collate all of this information from all the committees to make sure that we maximise the information and our aspirations so that we are represented well?
Well, I suspect if you're looking at it from a Parliament point of view, you might be as well to direct your question to your own convener or to the presiding officer. But I think it's a very important point. If I can maybe explain what we're doing within government, we have a regular meeting around where the Minister for Europe meets with all the other ministers that have an interest in European issues. By and large, that's everyone, because obviously the impact is on everywhere, so that we have a rolling anticipation of issues we should be either feeding into or indeed responding to. And clearly, in relation to what we hear coming out from the UK as to what their priorities are for negotiation, they can be, you know, we can be responding, and they can obviously feed that into Cabinet, so we collectively within Cabinet can have a view as to, you know, issues. Human rights, for example, has been the prime area of concern just now, but obviously with Michael Gove backtracking on the or not backtracking, but has yet to announce what his views are on human rights and what his proposals are, that may come back again at the appropriate time. So, but that has been to date a key focus across government, because that affects social justice, it affects our own justice portfolios, etc. From the Parliament's point of view, I would like to see all the different committees identifying issues in their portfolios as to the future of Europe. They should be doing that anyway, as part of how this term of the Parliament has been set up, I understand, to encourage that. And I think that one thing I would say is that, you know, this is of huge importance to us, not just in terms of economic issues, but in the future, the leadership that Scotland and the UK can have in a number of areas across Europe. climate change is an obvious one, not of this committee, of another committee. But bearing in mind, you know, as an experienced MSP, I know the pressures that are on committees, maybe not the ones that has least legislation as your own, but other committees will be having a big burden of legislation going into the final year. But that shouldn't preclude them taking evidence sessions at different points. How you collate that, and I'm quite happy to work in terms of, I suppose it's Rod Campbell's point, we don't really know the timetable for this, but perhaps we should have key milestones that we set ourselves as to when we might want to collectively, as a Parliament, review where we are in relation to what we know about and what our consideration is. We've obviously had a number of debates just recently on the international framework, European agenda area, EU reform perspectives, and indeed your own work programme as to what you anticipate. But I think we could probably work reasonably well together between, you know, with your convener and your clerks to anticipate, you know, particular points in time we might want to revisit. Okay, where do things stand, say, in the autumn? Where do they stand at Christmas, etc.?
I think you've more or less measured my concern, and it's not a concern, but my hope and aspiration. And I also agree with you. It's the time issue is an important one, the time factor, because we don't know how the negotiations are going to go with the UK and the European Union as well. So we need to make sure that all the good advice that we get from our citizens, we somehow make sure that that's available at a very short notice. And I think that's what I'm trying to get at, is that if we are talking to each other and if we keep the information as it comes in fresh, up to date, because I appreciate the pressures on everybody in all the committees, but I think because this is such an important issue, I'm hoping that perhaps between the Scottish Government and our committees, we can ensure that all the information that comes in is collated immediately almost, so that we've got it on shelf. So if there's any pressures on us in terms of turning things around, we're almost there, and it's just a matter of dusting them down. I would like to be in that position, and I'm just hoping that you would perhaps agree with me and explore that possibility.
Well, I think that would be best practice anyway, but I think that would be a responsibility of the convener, and we're happy to discuss how we can best do that.
Jamie McGregor.
Thank you. The UK government has indicated that it's going to pursue reform of the European Union for the benefit of all member states, and it wants to exempt the UK's smallest businesses from too much red tape, preserve the integrity of the single market, and expand the single market to break down remaining barriers to trade and ensuring that new sectors are opened up to British firms. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with these aims?
I've just gone through the issues around refit in particular, and you know, some of the points we're raising would actually be a benefit to small businesses. But a lot of the reform agenda, as I said, is already happening. I suppose the issue is what will be evidence as being new as part of the negotiation. Is that the real test, or is the general direction that we're actually improving things? I mean, the committee might not be aware, but for example, Scotland is contributing already in terms of looking at the Habitat Directive and how we can actually strip back some of the issues within that to enable progress without it being the burdens that have been there in that directive, unless they perhaps might have an impact on different organisations or indeed businesses depending on the area they work in. So that refit agenda, that's the regulation, the better regulation. You know, as I said to Rod as well, Rod Campbell, that actually an area that I think we've got common ground on, and actually our experience here on regulatory reform and what we're doing could help that. But I think you need to see what we haven't got are practical examples of how we know what we've got an idea of the general area that the Prime Minister wants to work in. What we haven't got yet is, well, what does that actually mean in specifics? What specific things does he want to change? In relation to opening up areas for business, one of the big agenda areas which is of interest to this Parliament and to our government is on the digital single market. Now, that's an area where there are significant opportunities for Scotland in particular. There are issues we have to be aware of in relation to creative industries and impact on film broadcasting, what that might mean. But the first presentation of the European Commission's digital single market proposals was actually to the Culture Council Committee, which I led on behalf of the UK government and responded to initially on behalf of the UK government. So those are areas that we're, if the question is, are we practically engaged and interested, the answer is yes, and I've probably given you two examples where, in practical terms, Scotland is already plugged in, already engaged, and certainly want to see progress on that. So I don't think there's an issue of conflict there.
Would the Cabinet Secretary, what would the Scottish Government's position be on national parliaments being able to work together to block unwanted legislation, which is one of the things that the UK government has suggested, and especially in relation to the countries that have their own currencies? Do you agree with preserving the integrity of the single market by insisting on protection for those countries that have single currencies?
Obviously, so much focus because of what's happening, particularly in Greece, has been on the Eurozone and countries that have the Euro. But obviously, with 10 countries not having the Euro, there's significant interest for those that don't have the Euro in terms of their interests and how they're dealt with. And I think in terms of the balance of power, basically, you've seen a regular again, this is not a new debate, a regular debate within Europe as to where that should lie. Indeed, the last probably tensions or expression of that is with the European Parliament, and to what extent does the European Parliament then have locus on the European Council in terms of their checks and balances. And I think what the Prime Minister is trying to do is to seek further movement in relation to national parliaments. He's not the first person to raise issues around there. The Dutch at different times have raised issues in a different way as to how that might happen. But of course, after 2009, there has been a system by which there can be a kind of flagging up of areas of national concern. What David Cameron's proposing, I think, again, we've not got the details, we need to see a bit more information, but some kind of red card issue, which is a veto. Now, we've already got a yellow card and an orange card system, in which case the national parliaments can indeed flag up issues and concerns. Now, since 2009, the yellow card has only been used twice. Now, it's important it's there, but it's only been used twice. One was when, in relation to the Monti II proposals, in relation to right to strike, it was subsequently dropped by the Commission. The second time it was used in relation to the yellow card system was, of course, in relation to the European prosecution issue, in relation to the European Public Prosecutor's Office. And that was an issue that this Parliament and these committees in this Parliament had real concerns of, and it was flagged up. That's only the two issues since 2009. And as regard the orange card, I can't give you an example because there hasn't been one. So that's an interesting reflection on needing to have a red card when actually the use of the previous the previous opportunities to flag up and intervene by national parliaments has not actually been used very much. And when it has been used for two areas, right to strike and the European Public Prosecutor's Service, it wasn't just the United Kingdom that had concerns, it was across the rest of the UK, particularly in the latter point, the Monti points weren't particularly relevant to us. But, I think that shows you that, it might be a presentation of an argument of having the power to do something without actually needing the power, because it's never been used or hasn't been used as much, even in weaker terms previously. So that maybe give you an understanding. And your second point was in relation to the currency, which I addressed first. Yeah.
Yes, I think you did. Thank you very much. Have I got time for one more small
very,
point?
Very quickly, Jim. Yeah.
Well, one of the difficulties of the euro going down that Scotland faces is that her agricultural subsidies are going to be worth a lot less this year than they would otherwise compared to other years. Does the Cabinet Secretary understand what the difficulties that this will produce for Scottish farming?
Well, in terms of your relation to subsidy, it's very important that we actually have a buoyant European economy in general terms, that obviously some of that is reliant on what's happening in the Eurozone. A lot of it is also reliant on what's happening in terms of growth and investment and expansion of the economy more widely. So it's in our interest to have a buoyant European economy, you know, more generally. In terms of Scotland, obviously our exports, a lot of them are agricultural, are very dependent on work, our work there. One of the things, you know, we don't just work and look in isolation as to say, well, you know, the state of Scottish agriculture will always just rely on the value of the euro or not on the value of the euro. We've got to pursue other areas. So, for example, one of the things, and you might be interested in, convener, in relation to the wider connecting Scotland agenda, the First Minister just announced that we're going to have an innovation investment hub location of the Scottish Government within Dublin. One of the areas of cooperation will be on agriculture. Now, clearly, in many ways, we are competitors with Ireland in agriculture, but on a global scale, there also is an opportunity for us to have a collaboration in terms of some of our promotion. So that isn't reliant on the value of the euro, that's also reliant on developing good relationships. And for example, the Access 6 programme is a very good example of cooperation of Scotland and Ireland in relation to working collaboratively with food and drink companies, SMEs in particular, which is really important in terms of growth and area in relation to accessing European money and funding. So, you know, we can't just, you know, rely on the value of Europe to determine the strength of our system. But in terms of subsidies, obviously quite clearly in relation to agriculture, you know, and you've heard this argument before, but we have one of the lowest percentages in relation to subsidy in terms of agriculture than any other country in Europe, and that's not in relation to anything to do with the value of the euro. It's just because we're not an independent country, and it would have been a different matter had the country voted differently at the last election. But I'm not going to go there because we've had that result, and I accept it. But you know, there are different pressures and dynamics.
Thank you very much,
Adam Ingram.
Thank you, convener. Can I just explore with you the First Minister's proposal that there needs to be a forum identified which would allow the devolved governments a direct input into the negotiations? How was that received by the UK government?
I think that's some. My understanding is we've not really had a response from it. I wasn't at the British Irish Council, so I wasn't party to the discussions that took place. But you know, I think there's a view, well, this is a reserved matter, so therefore the UK doesn't have to consult. And I find that very, very, very odd. Because, of course, there'll be an impact. We've just had a big discussion on agriculture. We've discussed business. These are issues that are, you know, it devolved to Scotland a lot of the responsibilities, never mind the impact on issues around migration that could have an impact on the domestic services that we have in Scotland that rely on the very well-qualified workers that we have here, the skilled workers that we have. So it's not just simply that, you know, somehow the relationship with the European Union is technically a reserve matter. Quite clearly there are, and it's already been recognised that there are issues that we need to be involved in. And I'll put this case as well. We were invited by the UK government to take part in the balance of competencies review, right? Because it was recognised, not just ourselves and at the GMC Europe Committee, Wales and Northern Ireland were invited to take part because quite clearly they realised and understood the impact and import of any changes to the balance of competencies, which is what David Cameron's trying to do in relation to the negotiations, would have an impact on us. So having invited us to provide evidence, which we duly did, and which also informed our own reform agenda that we published in August last year, having invited us to take part in it, all of a sudden we're being disinvited to be part of the discussions. So I think it's not just a case of trying to influence things for our own agenda. I think it would be sensible to have that cooperation and involvement. And whether it's more regularly within the regular contact within the GMC Europe structure, but that we need to meet more regularly or in a different form. And I suspect, you know, my own view is because some of it's on business, some of it's on other areas, that we could actually, the bilaterals that we have, and we can make just expand that. You know, for example, the finance ministers meet on a bilateral and indeed sometimes quadrilateral basis. We also need to try and look at that in relation to Europe. We're doing it on welfare. You know, think about it in terms of the welfare issues in relation to the Scotland Bill, which is separate. Why would you not see the developments on the European aspect in a similar vein, that we need to then have the dialogue between the relevant ministers? So any support from the committee in this area would be helpful, I think. But I think it's sensible, not just a case of we want to because we want to make a political argument. It's because actually it's common sense to do that.
Yeah, I think there's a bit of an irony in the UK government going to Europe trying to unpick a union, as it were, and they're so vociferous defenders of the United Kingdom as is at the moment. But they do seem to take a very little Englander kind of attitude, Anglo-centric approach that needs to be adjusted to take into account the four nations of the United Kingdom. It seems to be driven very much by Conservative Party politics as opposed to the national interest, as it were. So I just wondered, with regards to the Scottish Government's viewpoint, is there any scope for devolution of powers from Europe to Scotland, to Scottish Parliament? I'm thinking in terms of the likes of the fishing industry. We were arguing for a more regional kind of approach to things. So we could have a really distinctive voice in terms of any negotiation with Europe, if it was a serious negotiation. Because some allege that what we're seeing here is more a political exercise on behalf of the UK Tory government to satisfy its backbenchers, as we're taking on Europe. And they're going to announce we've achieved this, that, and the next thing when they come back. But it won't amount to a hill of beans. Is there a real agenda here to be pursued in terms of repatriating some powers that would have more would improve governance in Scotland?
I think that's a very interesting analysis, because, you know, we're quite clear there is a real agenda here for reform that we want to pursue, that we can engage with, that is sensible, that actually could achieve real results, and part of it on the regulation issues. But you make a very good point about regionalisation, that clearly in fisheries policy, that clearly is what we think should happen, and there's been an extent some progress with the fisheries policy, but we really do need, we could and should make progress. And there's a danger that in pursuing a very narrow political agenda, and that's my concern, is the negotiation, it was 10 areas, now I think it's down to 5 in broad areas, that it could become so narrow that we actually miss some of the progress that we could make in other areas, and actually areas where other parts of the European Union would want to engage on that agenda as well. And your political point, I suppose it's the strength that the Prime Minister may or may not have in trying to engage other countries. If it's perceived by other countries, as reflecting your remarks, that this is all about appeasing the backbenchers as his own political party, as opposed to taking the country on a journey of change, then that completely weakens a negotiating position. And actually, the real negotiation we want are on the areas. Why have we got pursuing more of a social Europe? You know, that's an area in terms of how we improve the opportunities for Europe. That's the big successes in the past have been on, you know, issues around workers' rights or equality issues. A whole variety of areas there. Again, on climate change, the UK has been very strong in this area. We've supported them in the European Council, but if we're diverted in talking just about a narrow agenda on negotiation that doesn't impact on the environment, on social issues, on jobs, on the real impact, we could be missing missing the trick here. So that's why I do think that, I mean, I've probably been more circumspect in my remarks about the politics of what David Cameron's doing. But, you know, that's the danger of it. And actually, we need a voice of reason, which I think the Scottish Parliament and the committees within the Parliament can be about, saying it's not a case of choice between reform and no reform. It's actually about having reform that will be meaningful, will have impact and affect people's everyday lives and the jobs and the organisations that we have. So, but that's about, you know, the European Union has never been something that's stuck in aspect. It's always moved. I just want us to be constructive in moving it forward and in the pace. I think we can do that. And actually, increasingly, the Scottish voice is being listened to.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, just on the back of my colleague Adam Ingram's questions there, one of the recommendations for the Smith Commission was to improve the current concordat on the coordination of European Union policy on the EU. And given that I believe the Cabinet Office guidance issued does not allow you to share any of the GIMC stuff until after the Council meeting, I mean, can you give us a wee update on whether there's been any progress on the update to that concordat via the Smith recommendations, and whether you believe that that's the transparency that should be there is not there?
I mean, I think it's fair in terms of our relations with the UK government. The meeting was only last week. We always give you, you know, feedback on the GMC Europe meetings. I've asked Hamza Yusuf, as the Minister for Europe, to now lead on those meetings. I used to do that. He's now doing that. I will attend if required and when required. But in terms of progress, we've provided evidence over recent months of what could, you know, what could and should happen. We've given them examples of good practice, as well as when things haven't worked as well, to try and encourage particularly colleagues in Brussels to have a better relationship with us. I think the example of my leading the UK at the Digital Audiovisual Council was quite important. I got a chance to influence the position in line that the UK was wanting to take in terms of what I said. I've managed to adapt that in a way that I thought was more conducive to our interests, but also the UK's interests. That's a good example, but, you know, I would reflect that the only council we ever seem to be able to get to lead on and speak on from behalf of the UK is that council, which is the one that is the education, youth, sport, culture council. I think practicing it elsewhere would be helpful. But, you know, in terms of a more formal response about amending the memorandum of understanding, that is still, although the commitment and agreement is to do that, we have yet to see anything. But Colin, you might be able to provide any further information on that.
Yes, I mean, it's an area where there's been work going on for the past few months at official level to follow up the commitments that were given at the Joint Ministerial Council at principal level, at the Prime Minister and First Minister level last December. And as the Cabinet Secretary said, we've provided evidence. We've also been working with the UK permanent representation in Brussels with our Welsh and Northern Irish colleagues to provide examples of how we can strengthen the role of the offices over there to make sure that we have more impact. But the Cabinet Secretary is absolutely right. We're still waiting on the detailed progress.
And we're not the only country that does this or is seeking to do this. Other countries, you know, on a regular basis, whether it's Germany or Spain, do it and see it's part of their constitutional arrangement to do that.
We have heard evidence from some of the regions across Europe and the rights and responsibilities and the, you know, some of the practice that's conferred on them to represent their issues from a local point of view as well. Which, Colin,
if I can just add that we had a Chatham House seminar here in Edinburgh with the Europa Institute, jointly held with the Flanders government and the University of Leuven, which was actually a really useful opportunity to look at an area, probably the most sophisticated way in which regional bodies can actually represent their country effectively and, I think a crucial issue, reach agreement in line with the negotiation timetables that exist in Europe, which has always been a fear that that somehow there might be might block the ability of the UK to negotiate. But actually, I think we had representatives from the Foreign Office there who were actually, you know, and so some positive elements. And these are the arguments we're putting forward in conjunction, as I say, with our Welsh and Northern Irish colleagues to seek to make some improvements. And with the Brussels end being the one where there is some progress, but we still need to see what's going to be proposed at the UK end.
Yeah, I think Flanders has got a very, very excellent example, and we've had them in front of the committee before, and certainly on my visit to New York, I visited them in New York, and to see the reach and the scope and the opportunities they have, you know, in the US, you know, not just within Europe, but, you know, that wider scope as well was very interesting indeed. I'm going to move on quickly to Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. It's hard, I think, to envisage the Prime Minister rushing into the referendum, holding up a victory on exempting the smallest businesses from new EU regulations and making that a referendum breaker. I think for some, the big issue, the big ticket issue is migration, immigration, and you mentioned that in your opening remarks, Cabinet Secretary. From the evidence that we've heard at the committee so far, we know that there are bigger numbers of migrants coming to the UK from outside the European Union and from within the European Union. So could you outline for us what the difference in thinking is between the Scottish Government and the UK Government on the immigration issue, and whether you think that issue itself will ultimately require a treaty change at the end of the day?
Well, the problem is we don't actually know what the Prime Minister's position is. That's the real issue. And actually, if you look at the broad areas in terms of what we understand his issues are, his issues aren't actually about necessarily migration. It's actually about benefits. It's not actually necessarily about, you know, from what we can gather, it's actually about restricting rights of migrants in work when they've been in work to claim benefits. And that's a different issue than their broader agenda about migration and total numbers, etc. So, you know, in terms of what's in our interest, you know, in migration is that we want to have talented people, skilled people, committed people to come here and work and contribute to our society, and they do. And we've seen very good reports, for example, from the University of the City of London showing the benefits, the economic benefits, that there's far more economic benefit of migrants to Scotland and in the UK than there are disbenefits, and they are net contributors to our economy. So if you didn't have those migrants, who's going to pick up the tab for the taxes that they were paying to our economy to pay for, you know, health, education, etc.? So you can see things through through a different lens, depending on where you're coming from. But the issues he's got is in relation to benefits and where you can have benefit change, and whether the benefit changes he wants would restrict freedom of movement. If he was to have or wanting to seek to affect freedom of movement, that's where you've had quite clearly across European Union expressions that this is a fundamental red line for many of the countries. They've made that quite explicit. If, however, he's wanting to get into the, not minutiae, but the detail of when migrants from the EU can or cannot claim benefits, that's a different territory. So benefits is a different territory necessarily than trying to be very crude about numbers of migrants coming from the EU, and indeed whether the benefit aspects would actually influence or change how many people came from different parts of the EU. So, of course, across the EU, you've got different systems, as you might appreciate, in terms of benefits. Some are contributory, some are to do with residency. And the issues that some countries have, and indeed it's not even a new discussion, it was discussed in 2011 by a number of countries, including the Netherlands and Germany at the time, is your definition of what your benefits are. And it's actually sometimes perhaps easier for those that have a contributory benefit system that you get your benefits after you have contributed for a certain length of time. It might be easier for them to adapt their situation for EU migrants than it is for those countries that have a residency basis. And I think, you know, again, I'm speculating here because, I have no detail. This is a level of detail we've not even had from the UK government as to what they're looking at. Countries have changed their systems. Ireland changed their system a couple of years ago, and it didn't require treaty change, but it was a change to the benefit system. And I think the issue we have, if you cast this as an issue about migration, and you hit against the freedom of movement, which is quite clearly a basic tenet of the European Union and its treaties, that would be a problem. If he's wanting to try and amend and adapt a benefits issue, well, that's a different issue. And of course, the UK system's already different from other countries, and a lot of it might be about what he does internally. And the issue then, would that require treaty change or agreement? But again, there have been some changes by some countries. For example, some of the discrepancies between Denmark and Sweden as to how students, for example, were treated in relation to benefits at different times. So again, we have this idea that everything is new under the sun in terms of because it comes from Britain, whereas actually quite often some of these issues have been looked at but done in a more, I suppose, more very practical level by other countries in the past. So, but until we have the detail, you know, all I'm giving you is a speculation, an analysis of what's been. Until we know what the actual ask is, it's very difficult for us to give you a view.
Do you think there's even time for treaty change if that were required within the rough time frame that we're looking at? It's 2017, we think.
It makes messages. Sometimes, you know, you get messages from the UK and previously from Philip Hammond that it was the end result that mattered, whether or not it required treaty change or not. And then you get an emphasis, oh, it's all about treaty change. Again, this goes back to Adam Ingram's point. The treaty change aspect seems to be probably about managing the backbenches of the Conservative Party than it is necessarily about actually achieving change. Deferred treaty change, at some point in the future might be something he could try and achieve. But I think there's also been a bit of speculation that there might have been some anticipation by the UK government that would be treaty change required for other reasons by other countries in relation to the Eurozone at some point. That looks in some of the discussions and the reports coming out of France and Germany in their discussions that perhaps treaty change might not be required to what they're trying to achieve in relation to their aspects. So the UK might have wanted to piggyback on what might have been happening anyway by opening up the treaties for other reasons. Again, just speculation. Again, though, it gives you an idea that in terms of time frame, that any major treaty change that other countries might have for other reasons are unlikely to happen when they're running into elections, and obviously France and German elections in 17 might have an impact in timescale. So again, you know, this is all, I suppose in committee you're looking for evidence. I can't provide you evidence because the facts and the proposals aren't actually there, but it's something to consider, and I think we need to keep close to as we proceed.
Okay. Cabinet Secretary, just very quick supplementary on that. The EU Commission has had a bit of a reshuffle yesterday, and they've appointed Jonathan Fall, whose responsibility will be analysis and response to Brexit. So obviously the EU Commission has now taken this very, very seriously, that the potential for, you know, lots of change there. And you're working very, very closely with Frans Timmermans, who is better regulation, which has obviously been an issue for this committee this morning. Has the Scottish Government been invited to take part in that group?
The one that was just set up yesterday. Yeah. No, I haven't opened my mail yet, so I'm not sure.
Right, okay.
We will look at. I'm obviously aware of the appointment by President Juncker of the individual you mentioned. In terms of our discussions, we will work with other either European institutions. Primarily with the UK government, that's where we've got to have our primary relationship in terms of influencing it.
Included in that group, or at least given a hearing by them?
I think I'd reserve judgment as to where that might go and why that's there, and in terms of our accountability. In terms of our accountability, it's we don't have a direct accountability to the European President and the European Commission. Our accountability is to you in this Parliament, and also in terms of our relationships, how we might work. So in relation to, you know, planning for Brexit, actually I want to plan not for Brexit. That's where we'll be putting, you know, more of our time and attention. It's not just in Britain's interests, it's in Scotland's interests as well, and that's where we have our emphasis. But I think it's quite right to say that there's a certain complacency policy, that there's an anticipation that even if it, you know, it came to a referendum, the vote would be to remain in, and we certainly see that in terms of the polls in Scotland, that would seem to be likely. But any referendum in any country at any time cannot be predicted, and if we learn anything from our own referendum more recently, you can have quite a lot of change in polls and positioning as you lead up into particularly the immediacy before the referendum. So I don't think we should be complacent in any shape or form, and those of us who want to see Scotland and the UK remaining part of the European Union have to be active in setting out that positive case. Don't wait until the referendum bill's passed. Don't wait until we hear what the negotiated position is. We should be making that case now because it's one that we should be continuously doing as politicians to justify the relationships and memberships that we're all agreed on. And I think European Union membership is one that I hope this Parliament will support the government in campaigning in a very positive way to remain a part of.
Thank you very much. I mean, I'll put you under a bit of pressure there, actually. So sorry about that. Very quick last supplementary from Adam Ingram.
Very brief questions. Just changing tact to our connecting Scotland inquiry. How are you doing in terms of your pursuing the issue of post-study work visas with the UK government? Is one brief question. And that's it.
So in terms of trying to pursue the agenda, Hamza Yusuf had a very useful meeting with one of the kind of senior members within the Westminster parliamentary system to make sure that the Westminster parliamentary system is aware of our issues. He did that recently. I think he's also meeting, and I can't remember if it's today or tomorrow, with the cross-party group that's been established on post-study work visa. So there's membership, for example, Claire Baker, and I think it's Liz Smith from the Conservatives. We have 159 names from institutions, from universities, from colleges, from businesses that are supporting the position. We think that this is, again, probably an area where, with a Scottish consensus around it, which we're looking to seek and build, we can have influence. We're not there yet, but I think the establishment of that cross-party working group on the post-study work visa is an important development. I'm sure, convener, that if you sought evidence from the Minister from Europe as to progress on that at the appropriate time, he'd be more than willing to share that with you.
I know the devolution committee took some evidence from university principals the other day on the UK VI issue, so it's maybe something we should communicate with them on as well. I'm going to finish there because we are on time, but we do have a full agenda. Cabinet Secretary, I thank you very much for your evidence to committee this morning. We do probably have some other questions that we would like to raise with you. Is it okay to write to you and seek some of that sort of a communication?
Yes, indeed. And we can discuss timescales for response, etc.
Yep, thank you very, very much indeed, and good luck. I'm going to suspend briefly just to allow us to change over witnesses. So if you want to get a very, very quick break, maybe 2 minutes or so. Good morning and welcome back to the European External Relations Committee, and moving on to Agenda Item 2 and our second Cabinet Secretary of this morning. And the focus of this agenda item is European Structural Funds. Can I welcome to Committee Cabinet Secretary of Infrastructure, Investment and Cities, Keith Brown. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. And supporting him this morning, Shane Rankin, who's the Deputy Director, European Structural Funds in the Scottish Government. Cabinet Secretary, I believe you have a brief opening statement.
I do. Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for the invitation to come along this morning to speak to the committee. As you'll know, I provided the committee with an update on structural funds in advance, and I hope you found that useful. And of course, we'll be happy to respond to questions on that. But if I could just start with a few remarks about the to put that update, which I provided previously, in some context, not least because I'm well aware that the committee has received substantial submissions on structural funds from three important and experienced stakeholders. As the committee knows, we are in the second year of the new EU seven-year funding cycle. We've got a new commission, new priorities and new programmes. I think it's fair to say from previous experience as well that that's always the most difficult part of the cycle. The new programmes have all been approved by the Commission, but the old programmes, of course, are still winding down. The old funds have been used up. The closure process itself is commencing. And I think it's useful to say that we have some significant issues in terms of the audit weaknesses which have been exposed by that process. Organisations which previously secured structural funds are hoping that the Commission's priorities haven't changed from that which they understood before, and that they will again secure funds. Organisations often hope to sustain and involve projects from one programme period to the next, and quite legitimately try hard to sustain capacity until the new programmes are operational and they can, as they hope, secure further structural funds. Linda Stewart's submission from UHI captures much of the complexity of this point in the cycle. Similarly, the SCVO submission captures, I think, some of their frustrations and, of course, anxieties for smaller organisations. We have tried, wherever we can, to mitigate the impact of this transition period. We've tried to stretch funding from the old programmes as far forward as we can, to recycle underspent funds, putting alternative gap funding in place, particularly for the national third sector bodies, but also for local authorities who use structural funds to support third sector bodies in their localities. I think what's different in this funding cycle is the economic crisis in 2008, which I think drove the Commission and Member States' expectations of the 2014-20 structural funds. So the priority for the funds has become much more focused on economic growth and youth unemployment. And for that reason, there's a significant allocation for youth unemployment in, for example, South West Scotland. Hence the expectation as well that the new Scottish programmes will concentrate their funds on innovation, business competitiveness and higher level skills, and not so much as previously on tourism and physical regeneration, which I think we recognise are extremely important, but given the programmes are not considered as a higher priority as the earlier areas I mentioned, business competitiveness, higher level skills and innovation. And also they seek to try and foster economic growth across Europe and make Europe more competitive with China and the US. What's not different in this new funding cycle is the Commission's focus on sound financial management of structural funds. They can't avoid that. I think you will know just as well as me the pressures which there are on the Commission to make sure that their accounts are in order and that they can account for the public expenditure that they're involved in. So we quite correctly are closely and constantly monitored by the European Parliament and the European Court of Auditors. And it's fair to say that the 2007-13 Scottish programmes were quite regularly criticised by Commission auditors for having too many projects, and the interruptions to these programmes, I think, prove that point. We've been therefore determined to avoid, where we can, the same kind of audit difficulties in new programmes. The committee will know that interruptions are triggered when organisations receiving funds are found not to have complied with EU regulations, the rules of the programmes or the procurement or state aid law, or where we cannot, after several years, trace the receipts for expenditure or invoices or staff timesheets. And I think it's absolutely correct to expect sound management of structural funds, but that does and has caused difficulties and disruption for smaller organisations
who have to repay funds or to have their grants cancelled after several weeks' work, several years' work, and that can be a severe interruption to their activities. So we've taken advantage of the requirement that we concentrate structural funds on a limited number of key themes to focus funds through Scottish Government policy directorates, its agencies and local authorities, on the basis that these organisations should have matched funding and the capacity to cope with regulatory compliance, which has increased over recent years, and the considerable EU audit burden, which has always been associated with structural funds. So, in conclusion, Convener, these organisations also have the capacity to run procurement and challenge fund processes, into which the smaller organisations who would previously have bid directly for structural funds can now bid without having to carry the audit burden and risk directly. So our approach is yielding fewer projects but much wider use of procurement and simplified costing methods. And it means that, for instance, structural funds are being used to expand a big lottery poverty and social inclusion programme, which means that third sector bodies now don't have to apply separately for big lottery funding, and then structural funds. And it means that local authorities can procure local third sector organisations to deliver employability programmes without those organisations having to be themselves accountable to European auditors. And it also means that Business Gateway can be expanded to support local growth companies in partnership with Scottish Enterprise and HIE. I won't go any further than that just now, Convener, but I think I've tried to illustrate our approach and demonstrate our concern not to put smaller organisations at risk, and also our concern to make best use of delivery capacity and available match funding, but also our overriding concern, which I know is a concern of the committee, to achieve the best possible impact from the structural funds. Thank you for that.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'm happy to go to opening questions from Jamie McGregor.
Thanks very much. Can I start with a question on the transitional funding for Highlands and Islands Minister? The UHI report to us that they have concerns that the concentration of activity and timescales does not allow for the intentions with the committee, the Highlands and Islands Territorial Committee, to be fully realised. And they go on about a process often being rushed, with papers coming out very late and information being circulated with insufficient time to agree a coordinated regional response. Can you comment on that and say how it could be improved or what the matter is?
Well, I think there is a tension there, there's no question of that, between trying to do these things as quickly as possible. We do have, I think it's fair to say, criticism from others that we're taking too long with some of these programmes. So I think it's just at that point, as I said in my opening statement, that it's a difficult part. The transition period is the most difficult part of that, and there are undoubtedly tensions. I'm happy, though, if the member wants to write to me with the specific concerns that UHI have, where they've seen that's something that's come to them as they would see it, I think implied by the member's question, that it's been given insufficient time for a response, and to look at that to see if we can improve that. But I think that is one of the tensions at this part of the transitional period.
Right. My second question is, in your letter to us of the 18th, you talk about the former suspension of the social funds and of 144 million euros and down to errors. Now, can you tell us what these errors were and what percentage of the total programme the errors represented in terms of pounds, shillings, terms of scale, percentage and money terms?
I'll perhaps bring Shane Rankin in shortly, because he was involved in the process previously as well, whereas I've taken on responsibility for this from October. But my understanding, the errors various. I think I mentioned some of them in my opening statement in terms of a lack of audit trail, so receipts not being kept. Sometimes the projects which were, or the funds which were sought, were for projects which changed after the funds had been received in some particular respects. So there's been a number of reasons why these errors have occurred, but in relation to the detail of that and also the percentage of what the total spend would be, I'd maybe ask Shane to come in and answer that, Convener.
Sure. In addition, the other principal reason for the errors was procurement failures of one kind or another. And the procurement failures are typical across Europe. There's something like 40% of the errors across Europe are down to procurement failures, which become more and more challenging as the years go on. You've asked specifically about the amount of money. The overall error rate, I think, there were two error rates on the two programmes, the Highlands and Islands and the Lowland programme. I think the error rate was about 3.9% in the Highlands and Islands, and it was 8.8% in the rest of Scotland. That was a provisional error rate submitted to the Commission in the 2014 Annual Control Report in December. After further work with the grant recipients, those error rates have reduced to, I think it's 2.3% in the Highlands and Islands and 3.8% or thereabouts in the Lowlands. In terms of the specific funds at risk, somewhere in the region of 1.4 million, I think, will be recovered and represents the scale of the error in the programmes. It's worth saying that from a technical point of view, these errors are obviously very disturbing, but there are errors and interruptions across Europe. There's something like 77 in the ERDF side at the moment and something similar in the ESF side. So it's about half the programmes at any one time that are interrupted across Europe.
In view of the fact that there were errors in the previous programme, in the 2000 to 2006 programme, and that a system was set up which was meant to stop these errors happening, are you disappointed by the number of errors that there seem to be?
First of all, yes, I mean, given, as I say, I've taken responsibility for this in October, to find out the error rate was as high as that, nearly 4%, in some places 5%. The reputational damage to Scotland, as well as the individual organisations, is substantial. There's a lot of work going on from the officials concerned to get it down below 2%, which is really quite important for other reasons as well, in terms of how much clawback there is. But by and large, what's happening here is the Scottish Government has to stand in to, you know, where there's a clawback or monies are not passed on from the Commission, but we've passed them on already to organisations, we have to pay for that. So, of course, it's in our interest to work those down. The fact that it still persisted after the last structural funds programme, which was a member's question, I think is worrying, but it also explains why we've done what we've done now in terms of the simplified procedures and also in terms of the way we've structured it so that we make sure that the organisations, by and large, which will have a managing role are ones which have the capacity to make sure they put the audit processes in place. So I think we have learnt lessons from the past and we're determined that we shouldn't see that high level error rate happen in future.
Well, the new simplified costs, have these been approved?
That's the process that we're following, yes.
Yes. Yeah. Because the COSLA response says that there's been significant effort to create new simplified costs. How much of that effort was funded by technical assistance?
Jean, do
you? Well, the effort is in two parts, the effort by Scottish Government officials, but also by the lead partners, the agencies that will use the simplified costs, and the technical assistance is only used to fund the managing authority, the civil service side of that. So no technical assistance was used.
Right.
Other than for the existing Scottish yeah. Government officials who were involved.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, Jimmy, Adam Ingram.
Thank you, convener. I've got two questions. The first one's a general one, the second one more specific. The first one is with regards to how the Scottish structural fund programmes will contribute to Scotland's achievements of the five Europe 2020 targets?
I think I've highlighted some of those in my opening statements, not least in relation to innovation and competitiveness. I think, though, what the Commission have asked us, or what we've agreed in terms of the funding programmes, is that they will reflect our new economic strategy, which, as you'll know, shifted a focus onto the fact that we, I think 2007, 2014, our economic strategy spoke very much about sustainable economic growth, but what we've done now is shift that to include the fact that you can have economic growth, but it's not shared by everybody. You're not achieving what you need to achieve. So there's been some synergy in relation to that. But, for example, some of the other areas I haven't mentioned in my opening statement, low-carbon transport, some very exciting projects in relation to that, which will obviously help both the 2020 goals, but also our longer-term goals in terms of carbon emissions. Just up the road, Edinburgh University, the Environmental Centre just up the road, we've done an excellent programme with them and various other partners working across Scotland to help to achieve that. So in terms of low-carbon infrastructure, we have £55 million in the ERDF going into that and sustainable economic growth. I mentioned business competitive and innovation, and just to give the member an idea of the, if you like, the level of priority attached to that, £65 million under ERDF for business competitive, £65 million for innovation, £40 million for access to finance, and also £35 million for next generation broadband investment. In terms of sustainable growth, £25 million for low-carbon transport, £55 million for low-carbon infrastructure, and £45 million for the resource-efficient circular economy accelerator. Don't ask me to explain exactly what that means, but I think it gives some idea of the priorities that we attach in trying to achieve the goals for 2020. It's also worth saying on the ESF side, inclusive growth, £156 million, so the biggest chunk of money going into that, which reflects what I was saying in terms of making sure that economic prosperity is shared equally, and £40 million for social inclusion and combating poverty. So those are some of the things which will help us achieve, and that's the kind of priority we're attaching to.
Yeah, I was particularly interested in how to raise the employment rate the programmes have been using used, and how and to reduce poverty. So these were two of the 2020 objectives that obviously dovetail with the Scottish Government strategy. So,
well, the other aspects of that. So, business competitiveness, we think will help increase employability, and I mentioned skills earlier on as well. But if you take that in concert with the other things which the Scottish Government's doing in terms of living wage, you know, it's our view that if you pay a living wage, by and large, the people that will earn a living wage will spend, I think we discussed this actually at the ICI committee a couple of weeks ago, they'll have to spend the money that they earn, and they should earn a wage that they can live on. But by doing that, that increases economic activity, which in turn helps the prospects for employability. We've also been concerned to make sure that access to employability, so again, a previous discussion was about supported employment, increases that access for everybody to the job market as well. So I would just point out to say that this works in concert with other aspects of Scottish Government policy, in particular procurement, which I'm responsible for as well.
Okay. Can I ask my specific question? It's really to do with the concerns raised by SCVO, that the use of public sector agencies to manage the structural fund programmes posed a risk to innovative approaches being adopted in addressing socio-economic issues like the ones I was highlighting there. They argue innovation and a priority for the social economy are the most obvious casualties of such a public sector-led strategy. Would you care to comment on those criticisms, Cabinet Secretary?
Yes, I've had a number of discussions with the SCVO, including a meeting with the Deputy Chief Executive to discuss some of these concerns. And I would say that a number of the concerns which they've raised in the submission mirror the concerns which they raised in the last transition period. And as I mentioned, that is a time of anxiety. And I am very alive to those concerns, but I'm also alive to the fact that we cannot be having the level of interruptions that we had before and clawback of money. That can be very damaging to the organisation concerned, to the Scottish Government and to Scotland's reputation in the EU. So there is that tension. The public authorities, which you mention, will tend to have a greater capacity for that audit function going forward and can sustain that. It takes, what we're trying to do is take some of that burden away. But I'm very concerned about the SCVO's anxieties about this. So, as I say, I've met with them and we've set up a particular forum where they can meet directly with officials from the Scottish Government. I've met with them, Alec Neil's met with them. That first meeting which has taken place of the Third Sector Forum, I think, was very positive. But I've said I'm more than happy to meet with them again and go through this with them. But I don't apologise for the fact that we have to make sure that we take the action necessary to avoid, first of all, a very high audit burden on some organisations. And it can become quite a disproportionate cost to a small organisation to perform that audit function correctly. So we are trying to help, but I'm aware of the anxieties. We have met with them and listened to those, and we'll continue to do that.
Okay, I just wondered if it was there was obviously a change to co-financing of programmes in the last. Did that impact on the problems that you mentioned? Was that a cause of the problems?
Well, there is an issue about some of the public bodies that we've spoken to being better placed to access match funding, which can obviously increase the pot that's available. And the public bodies, I think one of the other concerns that SCVO raised, that they felt there was a lack of transparency in the discussions between Scottish Government and local government. Now, I'm very keen that transparency should be there. So I've asked officials to look at how we can improve that transparency. So they're aware of what we're doing. I think they are aware of why we're trying to do it, but they still have those concerns. And we'll continue to try and meet those concerns and meet with them to discuss them. I don't know if you want to say anything further on co-financing, Shane.
I mean, the co-financing issue, it really goes to the heart of the change, because the old programmes generated something like 800 projects for about 800 million. It meant there were very small projects, and the audit burden on small organisations, as the Minister just said, very disproportionate. And the move to strategic interventions, concentrated funding, is a device whereby large organisations, public organisations that typically provide the match funding to the smaller ones in the first place, combine it before they offer it to them, so it simplifies the whole process, and the large organisations take the audit burden rather than the smaller ones, and procurement, flat rates, simplified costs are all measures that simplify that audit trail, and that it's all agreed up front what will be paid for what. And the actual cost methodology, which causes the audit trail issue that the Minister referred to, is avoided if we can establish all of these things. But there are tensions in the guidance and advice from the Commission on these things that make establishing the simplified cost quite challenging.
Thank you. Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I understand the total value to Scotland of all these structural funds is near enough €2 billion, and about roughly half of that comes directly from the European Union itself. What would the impact in Scotland be for all of these programmes if the UK was to leave the European Union?
I think one thing that's worth saying, it would be very hard to quantify what the impact, which is one of the worrying things about it, but we receive around £900 million, and obviously this would be, if we were to lose any significant chunk of that, would be very detrimental. Obviously, organisations and the Scottish Government plan some years ahead with the anticipation of receiving these funds. If there was a threat to those funds, even if that threat didn't eventually materialise, people have to take decisions early on to try and anticipate that threat. So I think the damage, if we were to be forced out of the EU, could be substantial. Quite a substantial amount of it is already committed and I think couldn't be changed. But the uncertainty that we create, I think, could be extremely damaging. And you're often talking about programmes which, you know, impact very directly on people's lives, disadvantage people's lives. So I think the cost, whatever the eventual cost in finances, and it would be hard to quantify that, the costs in terms of uncertainty and the damage to these programmes could be substantial.
Is there any commitment or even discussion with the UK government about, should there be an exit from the European Union, the UK making up that particular shortfall? Because if the funding suddenly ceases from Europe, then either the programmes end or they continue to be funded from other sources. Has there been any discussion or commitment from the UK that they might make up any shortfall?
There's been no commitment of that kind. I think as the process towards the referendum gets underway, that question is going to be asked. We'll be asking that question in the Scottish Government. I think we are very keen, as a government in the referendum that's coming, to take the very positive approach about the benefits of Europe. So we're not looking to concentrate unnecessarily on some of the downsides to that. We're trying to make sure we're as positive as possible, but you're quite right to say we should have the best and clearest information possible about what would be the effect of a no vote. I mean, it's still the UK government's position that they won't want to reform the EU but want to stay in. I think that's the latest position. So we should work with that, but I think you're right, we should understand what the risk will be, and I think that will become clearer as the referendum campaign itself goes forward, but we will be asking those questions.
And lastly, you mentioned the Youth Employment Initiative, which is particularly important for the south-west of Scotland. Is that one of the programmes that will continue after the revisions, I think, that you outlined in your opening remarks?
Well, there's the extra programme, you're right, devised for regions with youth unemployment. That was in 2012, where youth unemployment was in excess of 25%, and that allowed concentrated funding on measures which would assist young people under 29 into work or training. The South West region qualifies and received that funding. It has been committed, has to be committed by the end of 2015. And it's worth saying, I think, that the total programme for South West Scotland in that regard is around £100 million. So that's been committed, or to be committed by the end of this year. Sorry.
Thank you. McTaggart.
Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning, Mr. Rankin. And apologies if you think that you've already covered this ground, but some of the information from SCVO, they also told this committee that as a result of the reduced involvement of the third sector, marginalised groups in society were not being reached. Can the Cabinet Secretary express how what we are doing within Scotland to try and reach those hard-to-reach groups and how we are supporting them?
Yeah, I think on the first part of the question, which, as you rightly say, we've had some discussion of, there is no attempt to try and not work with the SCVO. I think what we've done has been, in our view, trying to be helpful to the SCVO. So their work is about trying to reach marginalised people, and we want to try and help them do that. And if you can take some of the risk away from the audit function and some of the burden that applies, then that should help them reach more people in relation to that. So that's the overall aim. Now, despite that, you still have the representation from SCVO, which expresses concerns, and one of the main concerns, as I mentioned earlier on, is they think that they'd like to know more about, be more transparent about the discussions that the government is having with local government to make sure that those concerns are being addressed. So we are determined to do that, to make it as transparent as, but we're not trying to cut them out of the process. So I think they have those concerns. We are trying our best to address them. As to the actual programmes themselves, I've mentioned some of the programmes previously that we'd had. So you've got the employment pipelines for youth employment, social inclusion and combating poverty as well, and particular focus on rural programmes too across Scotland, because rural poverty often seems to be mentioned, if at all, after urban poverty. So we have those programmes to try and do that. And the way that we're approaching the administration of the structural funds is designed to help them maximise their impact.
Thanks, Convener. Thank
you very much. And Hans Alamalek.
Good morning. Cabinet Secretary. I've got two points that I was hoping to raise with you today. First is broadband and Wi-Fi facilities across Scotland. There's a lot of parts of Scotland that we just don't have the service, and the European Union did reduce the fund, so I know that there are challenges before we even kick off. But one of the things I was hoping that you might be able to shed some light on is if, for example, there are organisations who've received funding and have not been able to deliver, could we negotiate that that money can then be passed on to that sector to try and bridge that gap that we have?
So on the first point you raised, I think we'd acknowledge how much work there is to be done, not just in broadband, but even in terms of mobile phone connectedness. I would say, and this is not an excuse for where we're at, because I don't think where we're at is satisfactory, that this year I went to Canada for Scotland Week, and they have exactly the same issues. Although it is worth thinking about the fact that they talked about how you provide broadband effectively without having a large population in many parts of Canada to sustain that. Now, we could fit into one of the provinces quite comfortably, in a number of the provinces in Canada quite comfortably. But they have the same issues there, so I don't think these issues are unique to Scotland, but we do have to improve it. I should say that the lead for digital connectivity rests with Mr. Swinney, but I do have a responsibility there as well. So we are trying to maximise that, and a lot of the funding is not actually, some of it is EU funding, but it's also the bulk of it from the UK government. We rely on the funding that comes from them as well. So we can take, as I understand it, and perhaps Shane could come in on this as well, the point about whether we can use funds not spent in one area for this. I think it's possible to do that from rural programmes and for to put that into broadband, but maybe ask Shane to come in the detail of that.
Sure. There's been an allocation from the current programmes for the current broadband programme, and that hopefully will be drawn down in the next 6 months or so to support digital investment. In the new programmes, we've been somewhat limited in terms of the capacity to use broadband infrastructure. The Commission didn't see this as a priority for the UK, but they were persuaded that in the rural and remoter parts of Scotland, there was definitely an argument, which even more unusually, we persuaded them that there was a rural, from the rural programmes, there should be an allocation specifically for broadband. So that has been made, and that will see continue to support the investment and the rollout of the infrastructure and programme over the next 6-7 years, whatever it is.
If I could just add to the point that's been made by the member that in terms of infrastructure, in my previous role as Minister for Transport, there was a great deal of focus, quite rightly, on rail and road and other infrastructure in terms of connectedness. But there's no question that for many people, broadband connectedness increases their access to healthcare, potentially retail opportunities, which is very important in rural areas, and also increases the ability, for example, to work from home or conduct business from home, so it helps the environment. So I think you're going to see and are seeing now an increased emphasis on broadband connectedness or digital connectedness for people, especially in rural areas, whereas perhaps the focus has been on road and rail. For some people, having the right road to where they are or the right railway service will be less important than having that digital connectivity. So we in the Scottish Government and the infrastructure, what we're trying to do is recognise that and try and make as much progress as we can. So you're seeing new developments in terms of the hardest to reach areas and the use of satellite broadband and things like that to try and increase that. So we are trying to work in a joined up way in relation to that.
I'm pleased that you've obviously got that in a priority area, and I'm hoping that perhaps if there is any money left somewhere else, that can go into to support that view that you have. So thank you for that. And the second point I wanted to raise was in terms of youth employment initiatives. I only yesterday found out that some colleges are not as eager to promote that training as they could be. So I will be writing to the Cabinet Secretary for Education, but I will also keep you in the loop as well, because part of your portfolio is in terms of about employment and ensuring that we have decent employment. I just wanted to flag that up today to you as just a point of information, and perhaps we can readdress this at a later stage. But I think it's important that colleges play an important role. I think colleges can play a very important role in this, and I think that's important that they seem to be doing it.
Well, if part of the member's point is that some of the colleges are not maximising the opportunities that might be from European funding, that would be certainly something for me to be interested in, although you're right to say that the primary responsibility lies with the Cabinet Secretary for Education. There is support within European programmes for one area where we know we've got a lot of work to do, which is digital skills, to go back to your previous question. There is a gap there. Interestingly, I've made the point in this very room at a previous reception that perhaps employers should take more cognizance of the number of veterans leaving the armed forces with these skills, even if they're not articulated or expressed in the same way as civilian skills, so they can be the same skills. But if what the member is saying is he's aware of circumstances where colleges or the FE sector is not maximising the opportunities from European funding, I'd be very interested to hear that.
Okay. Thank you. Lord Campbell.
Morning, Cabinet Secretary. Rural Scotland, particularly rural Scotland outside the Highlands and Islands, are they getting a fair crack of the whip from structural funds?
Well, I suppose there's two ways. You can look back and see the extent to which the rural sector did well in the last set of structural funds, and also look forward to see how well we're providing for putting the basis in place for the next 6 years for rural areas. I think even in terms of just public, maybe not public perception, but perception amongst the agencies involved, the rural side of things has always had a very high profile. I know there are concerns, and some of those are dealt with by my colleague Richard Lockhead, but I think there's been, through the Leader Programme, for example, and others, there's been a very high profile for those. And, of course, it's not all strictly rural, but much of the agricultural support and fisheries support has an impact on rural communities as well. So all local authorities do get support in relation to this for... you know, especially where they represent rural areas. So I think it's probably true to say, as of other sectors, that we have done a great deal, but there's more that we can do. And I'd be interested if the members got any particular examples where it feels that we could do better in terms of rural provision.
I think one of the issues that's often raised rurally is the bureaucracy of the Leader Programme. I don't know whether going forward that will be any easier. I don't know if you've got any comments on that one in particular. Yeah.
Well, I'd maybe get Shane to come in the specifics, but I've certainly had that representation made to me. This last year was in the west of Scotland in a rural area, and the point was made quite forcibly to me. It can be very difficult for very small, sometimes tenant farmers and others, to go through all the compliance that's required. I think from what I've said earlier on, we're very alive to the idea of trying to reduce the burden, the audit burden. And it's worth saying that that's going against the grain of what Europe is doing. Europe and the Commission is quite rightly coming under a lot of scrutiny. It doesn't get its accounts approved. And it's got real challenges in some of the new Eastern European countries where the capacity is not the same as it is in the countries which have been members of the EU for quite some time to deal with the infrastructure there. So the EU or the Commission is increasing the audit function or compliance regime in those countries, and we are being caught with that. So what we're trying to do is try and mitigate that as best we can. And yes, sometimes it will come down and impact on very small organisations, but I don't know if you want to say something, Shane, sure. Leader.
Leaders was obviously challenging in the last programme, and it's supported from the European Rural Development Programme rather than the ERDF and ESF programmes. But one of the other significant changes in the new regime is Minister's agreement that we govern the rural marine structural funds programmes as one, and that we seek alignment between those programmes. So there's dialogue about what Leader will do and what the structural funds programmes will do, so that there isn't confusion or overlap or competition at a local level into two funds for the same thing, which would cause difficulty. So some of those bureaucratic issues hopefully will be lessened in localities in relation to Leader because of the governance arrangements and the alignment between the programmes.
Thank you. Slightly different question in terms of kind of the Youth Employment Initiative in South West Scotland. What are the expectations of this project, how are we going to measure success or otherwise with it?
Well, as to the technical measures, I'll maybe let Shane come in on that, but obviously you look over time. I think it's worth saying that although we've managed to attract substantial funding for the South West, our record in terms of youth unemployment is exceptionally improved from, say, last year. So I think we've got the lowest youth unemployment in the UK now. There's been a lot of work done, not least, as Angela Malik mentioned earlier on, through education initiatives. But I don't know if you want to talk about, sure, the technical measures that we achieve.
It's actually an interesting question. It goes to the heart of the whole Commission approach to all the programmes, where they're much more target-oriented, outcomes-driven, payment on results and so on. And in terms of the Youth Unemployment or the Youth Employment Initiative, because it's a shorter programme, front-loaded to be committed by the end of 15 and so on, not supposed to run to 2020. The targets, I think, for that are relatively simple. It's people, young people into work, young people up to 29. I can't quote you exactly the targets, but it will be of that order, very, very specific, clear-cut targets.
I think it...
Certainly, yeah. Yes. We'll write to you.
We'd appreciate that.
We will get back to you. And I think also related to It's changed quite substantially, as has female employment over the last number of months, where there's been some real progress made. So how the targets remain relevant, it's an interesting question. So we'll provide the information both on the targets that we expect to achieve and the way that things have changed over the last year because of the progress that's been made to the committee as a whole, convener, or to the member? To provide it to yourself?
To the committee, it would help with our deliberations. I've got... you've completed your questions, Mr. Campbell. I've got a quick final supplementary from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, convener. Just to follow up on the questions that Anzala Malik raised there on broadband, Cabinet Secretary, we understood that mobile roaming charges were meant to have been eliminated by this December throughout the European Union, and that was a fantastic move, I think, that would have supported the principles behind the digital single market. We also understand that it wasn't the Commission that reversed this commitment, that it was the Member States somehow, but there's a bit of lack of clarity in who exactly was responsible for that. Is there anything that the Scottish Government can do to find out how those circumstances came about and hopefully to lobby for that to be reinstated with a clear timetable for that to happen? Because if the European Union is promoting the principles within the digital single market, that seems to me to be a key aim that would be in there to support that initiative, and it seems as though they've reversed on quite an important commitment there.
Yes, we can do that. I'll find out exactly what the circumstances, who was responsible for it, and when it's expected to be completed by. As you'd see, I think a lot of change has taken place already. I think in my own experience, I was in Milan on Monday, and you get the usual message when you get there and what the cost of the calls and texts were, and it was substantially reduced from what I remember from in recent years. But we will find that out and write back to the committee with how it came about, who's responsible for implementing it, and when it will be completed. Happy to do that.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. We've obviously got some time constraints this morning, so we do have some additional questions for you. If we can write to you on that, that would be very helpful. But specifically, if we can highlight the issue around the youth employment issue, some information that we have is the youth guarantee has been criticised and under a question mark, you know, within the European context, Europe-wide. So, you know, some detail on that specific, the targets, whether they've met the targets and, you know, how many jobs, that type of thing, would be really helpful to inform this committee and the work that it does taking forward. Youth employment, broadband and a few other things are the main topics for this committee. There are things that we keep a close eye on, so anything that you can help us to inform that process would be very gratefully received indeed. And can I thank you very much on behalf of the committee for coming along and answering more questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to briefly suspend for 5 minutes just to allow people to get a quick comfort break. Good morning and welcome back to the European and External Relations Committee. Our agenda item 3 this morning is consideration of a report from the Scottish Parliament's members of the Committee of the Regions. Stewart Maxwell sends his apologies for not being able to be at committee this morning to present his report because he is a member of the Devolution Committee, which is meeting at the same time as us this morning. You've got a paper in your papers. It's there for comment, clarification, or question.
Convener, I'm grateful to our colleague Stewart Maxwell for providing that report, and I notice that he informs us that one of the committees is going to begin an inquiry into the digital single market. I'd certainly be very keen to keep close touch with that to see what the scope of that inquiry might be, and whether this committee has got any, is there any possibility for our committee to feed into that in terms of asking them to consider particular matters?
Okay, we can ask that, yeah?
Yeah,
you agree with that, Hans-Ala?
Yeah, absolutely.
Is there any other questions or comments? Rod?
At the 110th plenary session, there was obviously a statement from Cecilia Malmström about TTIP, and that seemed to slightly faded away. I don't know if we could actually inquire, you know, kind of what involvement the Committee of the Regions are having with the TTIP debate.
We can ask that as well, absolutely. Adam.
Just wonder, obviously a relatively new member of the committee, I assume that the members of the Committee of the Regions, that the parliamentarians that we have, would normally come along and have a wee chat with the committee about what's going on. Would that be correct? Because I think it would be helpful if we did have that.
There was no formal mechanism for the Committee of the Regions to communicate with this committee, so this particular committee set up this process, and that's why we now get the six-monthly report, isn't it? That's why we now get the six-monthly report, because as you can see, they pack so much into the work that they do, and some of it is very, very topical, and some of it is very important in the ongoing work that we do as well. But this is quite a new phenomenon, so we've been developing it as we go along. But yes, you would usually come along to committee, and that's why we have apologies from my colleague this morning. Patricia Ferguson came the last time and delivered her report, didn't she? She's got a similar situation with being on another committee. So that makes it difficult, but as you can see, it's a very comprehensive report. They're happy to answer any questions.
I think it would be useful, convener, if we can get a mutually agreed time for the members to come along and just have a general discussion with them without being terribly onerous on them, but just an exchange of views would be helpful.
We can look at that for the new session starting in September, absolutely.
Chair, did we not actually agree to ask Patricia to come and give us a verbal report as well? Even though she couldn't make it on that particular day, we did suggest that maybe she could come back and give us a report.
It's the take turns to do it. One does it one six-month cycle, and one does it the other.
So. A verbal report, I was just wondering.
No, well, but that's what Adam's asking for, so we'll try and set that up for the session starting again in September.
Okay.
We'll get some.
I'm happy with that.
Yeah. Okay. Happy to have this circulated to relevant subject committees. Yeah.
Yes.
Highlight paragraphs 5 and 6.
It's fine, you've done that.
Yeah, we've done that. Yeah, it's about alert on the Rural Affairs and Climate Change Committee and some of the very particular issues that have come up in the report. Happy to do that. Excellent. Thank you very much indeed. So we are moving on to agenda item 4, which is our reports from the Scottish Government, and that is another pretty substantial paper in your papers. We have Horizon 2020, Foreign Language Learning, and our usual update on transposition of EU directives. So again, any questions, comments, clarifications?
I'm not sure how well we're doing in the language scheme, how many more schools have joined, if any. I was trying to get a practical hold on if we have increased our language bank, and also if other schools have joined in or not. And also we were going to try and monitor the high schools, the secondary schools, So once the children who've graduated from primary and moved on to secondary, whether those languages are available to them so that they complement what they've already previously learned. I don't think we have that detailed information. Perhaps you could get that at some stage.
I mean, there is an implementation process paper at the back of that. But yeah, there's a section in the letter. It says, since by previous update, implementation of 1+2 policy has gathered pace. And it's that pace and the content of that pace that we need to know.
Yes, please.
Yeah. So we can ask for that. Yeah. Anne.
Thank you, Convener. My experience so far in being involved in a lot of the cross-party working groups on the 1 and 2 language policy, it's not working very well at all. But can I highlight, there has been, I think Dr. Alistair Allen has highlighted that Michael Russell, MSP, has agreed to sponsor a parliamentary reception on Thursday the 24th. I think that will be hugely important for some of our cross-party working groups to be involved in alongside our MSPs. But it does concern me, Convener, that we aren't punching above our weight.
Well, we need some of the detail, don't we? Yeah, so we can ask for that. Yeah. Rod.
On the same point, I see on page 4 it does say that local authorities have been asked to provide a strategic update to help build a picture of how provision is developing in Scottish schools since the strategies were submitted in 2014. So it might be an idea to, you know, to request the Scottish Government when those are in a specific period to give us as a committee an update. But there are some positives in terms of this report. The vast increase in the number of language assistants seems to be a positive. So,
because they dropped greatly, and I think the feedback we had from the British Council a few weeks ago was that they had managed to push that number up as well. But I think there's a number of positives in here, but there's some things that we need some clarification on and how well it's doing. So happy to do that. Yep. Okay. So we're moving on now, very swiftly, well done everyone, to a paper and an agenda item. Sorry, Jamie.
Can I just come back on one little point which I meant to ask on that language thing?
Yeah, of course.
It was just that they say that the interest in the LA programme continues to grow, provisional numbers for the coming academic year, an increase of 100%. I was wondering if we could just possibly get the actual figure, because 100%, from 1 to 2 is 100%, if you know what I mean. It'd be quite interesting.
Well, I know we visited many, many more projects than just one, so that's part of the detail I think we should ask for. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So that's moving on now to agenda item 5, which is a paper that we have on the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. And it's actually a letter that we have from Cecilia Malmstrom with an update and a response to our committee inquiry. And for your information, SPICE will do an updated research paper for us, published in September, to allow us... For when we get back on the 3rd of September. So it means then we can have an update on what has happened over the intervening months since our committee inquiry has been completed and since the letter from Cecilia Malmstrom. We have yet to receive a response from the UK government on our committee inquiry paper. So, I may be looking for a committee's support to write again to the UK government to ask them for that update. We've had one now from the EU, so one from the UK would be very helpful. Rod?
And at that point, I think, correct, I've lodged a question in relation to any discussions which might be taking place about Cecilia Malmstrom's possible discussions with representatives of the Scottish Government. I'm not sure, I don't believe I've received an answer to that question yet, but obviously can share that with committee members when it's received. But I'm thinking in terms of going on, obviously it's going to be very grateful to have that SPICE update in September, because we know that the Trade Committee in Europe will be meeting on the 29th of June, I think, to consider whether or not the in excess of 100 amendments on which were to be considered by the full European Parliament earlier this month will now be discussed in September, or whether or not some other arrangement will come to be, but I think they're meeting on the 29th.
That's a postponement from the meeting a few weeks ago, wasn't it, where it was postponed?
But the Trade Committee, as I understand, it's meeting on the 29th. I think it would be helpful to, obviously, our European representatives are at the cutting edge of this, if we could perhaps put into our work programme the possibility of a session by video link or otherwise with members of the European Parliament to, you know, to discuss where we are with TTIP at a convenient time early in the autumn.
That would be very valuable indeed. Anne?
Thanks. I'm not sure if this has already been covered, but there has been an offer to meet with the Cabinet Secretary, John Swinney. Has that date been set?
That was the point of my question. I was trying to focus on, you know, what is the current position at, and I put a parliamentary question in which is as yet unanswered. So,
and thereafter, would there be an opportunity if she's coming to meet with Mr. Swinney that she would meet the committee?
We can only ask.
Thank you.
But I think, given, you know, she's been very, very good at communicating back with the committee. I would hope that if she was here in Scotland, then that would be a good opportunity to come and meet with the committee. Whether formally or informally, we would need to decide that, yeah.
And just the other point, to go on the back of my colleague Roderick Campbell's suggestion, I think it would be a superb idea for us as a committee to be involved with our MEPs, whether that's by video link or face-to-face.
The group of us that are going out to Strasbourg, we have managed to secure a sit down with the MEPs out there, and it's plenary session, and I think maybe at that time in October there might be a bit of a focus on some of this that's happened at the time. But no, all very good ideas. Adam?
Yeah, just on the point in the letter that she said she'd be delighted to consider it, arranging a visit to Scotland, and I wondered if we had any further communication with her office and that, so to meet ours. So
I think we should offer the accommodation here.
Yeah, well, okay.
Willie.
Thanks, Convener. Could I just refer members to one of the sentences that Mrs. Malmstrom has provided for us in her letter? She says, for the benefit of the members, that she made a joint declaration with her US counterpart confirming that TTIP will neither require the European Union or US governments to privatise any service. Now, that's not quite the same as we have no intention of doing so. Not requiring that doesn't mean that you ultimately won't do it. And that's where the concern for a lot of the public still lies. It's not abundantly clear that they've got no intention of doing this. So maybe it's a semantics thing here with this particular letter, but I would hope that we could further tease that out if Mrs. Malmstrom actually comes to the committee.
Yeah, we can have a look at that and clarify it. But I mean, you know, within the context of that, the next sentence is about not being able to comment on whether there is a need for the UK government to offer any additional protections, and that's where the issue arises for us here in this Parliament, is that does the UK government have to ask for that reservation on behalf of Scotland, or is it just done within, you know, our intergovernmental communications within the UK? And that's what's not clear for me, is that unless the UK specifically asks for that reservation, does that then leave us open to some of the requirements or non-requirements of any policy paper or policy intention? That's the question. That's a key question for me here. So we can ask all of these questions and invite the commissioner here to Scotland, and hopefully we can have a much more in-depth discussion on all of these issues. Yep, I'm happy to do that then. So I have got, on this topic, setting up an MEP meeting as early in the session after summer as possible, and further questions and clarifications sought of Commissioner Malmstrom, and an invitation to attend this committee.
Yep.
Does that cover everybody's asks in that respect? Yep. sorry, to the UK minister as well. Oh, yes, and chasing up the UK on their response to our committee inquiry report. Happy with that? Okay. And that takes us to agenda item 6, which is a Brussels bulletin. Willie.
Thanks very much, convener. Slight change of tack for me with the Brussels bulletin. On page 3 there, there's quite an important item, I think, on the dairy issue and particularly on milk prices. I know that this is an issue that affects not just Scottish milk producers, but right throughout Europe. There is absolutely no stability in pricing for milk, particularly in Scotland, and it's potentially and seriously damaging and threatening the industry. The paper there talks about the concerns about it, of course, and that there's some kind of basket of tools available to try to influence this and bring about a wee bit of stability for our farmers and milk producers. I would be keen to find out just exactly what these tools are and what the intention behind deploying these tools might be to see whether they might assist Scottish farmers and milk producers to get a fair price for their milk and some kind of consistent and stable price that lasts for a period of time and doesn't go up and down like a yo-yo as it does at the moment.
I believe the Rural Committee of this Parliament has just starting to undertake an inquiry into milk prices in the dairy sector. So maybe keeping in close contact with our colleagues in that committee is a way to address this. Jamie?
Well, I was just going to make that point that, I mean, some of my constituents in the Kintyre area, the Campbellton area, have been getting 13 to 16 pence for their milk when it's costing them 24 pence to produce it. Most of them are customers of First Milk. And they're just, you know, it is a real crisis. It really is a crisis. So I hope that this will do something, you know, quite quickly. Something needs to be done quickly.
Well, we should maybe look at the criteria set by the Rural Committee for their inquiry and see what that involves. Hansala.
Thank you, Chair. One of the committees that I'm on, it's the Public Petitions Committee. There was a case by a farmer who felt that their human rights were infringed when the pricing was set in the first place. I just want to lay down that, you know, there's that aspect of things that we need to be careful how we actually address this so there are no losers. I think that's the important issue. So whilst the Rural Committee is looking at this, I think we might want to share that with them so that, you know, when they're in the deliberations, they try to ensure that we don't end up with people who are on the losing end. I mean, the idea is to try and make sure that there's a win-win for all of us and most importantly, to protect our industry. So I think we just advise them of that fact. They may already know, but just in case they don't, I think it's nice to just let them know.
Well, we should make sure that this section of the Brussels Bulletin is highlighted, to that committee with their comments. Yeah.
Thank you,
Jim. Yeah, Rod.
In terms of biodiversity, I was quite interested by the NGO BirdLife study and also by the fact that requesting the Commission to start working on a targeted and effective biodiversity conservation policy. But I just wanted to flag up if we could perhaps follow through any response from the Commission to that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Can I draw your attention to the section at the back of the Brussels Bulletin, which is actually a spice paper on something that was raised by a number of MSPs in this Parliament to this committee, and it's the anti-money laundering legislation. There's quite a detailed paper here, and I know that the Chief Executive of the Parliament as well has been doing some work on this and what it means for us all, and maybe some overzealous banks getting a bit ahead of themselves and some of the aspects of this. So it's a very detailed paper. It gives us an update on the fourth anti-money laundering directive, which was only adopted a few weeks ago. My inclination is to ensure that the Chief Executive of this Parliament gets a copy of this and maybe it's then distributed directly to all MSPs to ensure that they understand what politically exposed persons actually means and the impact that it will have on their day-to-day financial transactions and things. So, Is that agreed? Yeah, Hansala.
Can I also add as a cautionary note that perhaps we can do something in terms of public awareness? I was seeing a television programme where a youngster was stopped from leaving the UK because he had a large sum of money that he couldn't produce evidence for there and then where the money came from. And I think it's all about having prior knowledge and so that they can ensure that they do have the evidence if they're taking large sums of cash for business or pleasure. So I think we need to disseminate that information to the general public as well. I think that's important.
Hopefully the individual members will help with that as well.
Yes.
Okay.
To members of this parliament, so fully aware. Obviously, I've got personal experience from some time ago of this issue, so I'm sure plenty of members are not aware of it at all.
You're not alone. Many members have contacted me and my capacity as convener on this issue, and that's why we commissioned SPICE to do this bit of information. And I know that the Chief Executive and the corporate body are working very, very hard to ensure that people get the right information. So a very important piece. A great example of how something that comes from Europe has an impact on us and we don't realise it until it's right on us. So, hence, Horizon Scan is always a good thing. But it's a good paper, and I thank SPICE for putting it together as quickly as they have. And we should just keep our weather eye on it. Yeah, okay. Thank you very much. That completes our business in public today. So I'm going to suspend now to go into private and thank everyone for coming along. Thank you.